Everyone, and welcome to Dr. Deep State. Today we have a very special guest, Theo Howard. He's been on the show before. He's one of our very favorite guests. He's the host of Will and I's favorite channel, Vendée Radio. And Will is going to kind of give a more of an in-depth intro for you here, but we're very pleased to have Theo on our show today.
Yes. Theo Howard is the contributing editor for 1 Peter 5, and also the host and creator of Vendée Radio. And generally, he's just a brilliant commentator on all things Catholic and within the European tradition. And he's joining us today to discuss a topic that we think is very significant for the moment that we're in culturally. He's entitling his presentation, The Controlled Noticing. So we'll hand it over to you, Theo.
Well, thank you very much, Will, and thank you very much, Dr. Haugen. It's for those very kind words. I'm not sure that I quite deserve them, but it has been a real honor to collaborate with you both. And I can say that for Dr. Haugen's latest release, In Pursuit of the Metaverse, that was such a an arresting work and something, one of those books that one reads that really shakes up one's worldview or enriches it, brings new aspects to light which one hadn't considered. And I think the work that you're doing there, the work within deep politics, looking at the intersection with the spiritual dynamics to do with eschatology, salvation history, and crypto theologies, all sorts of very interesting areas. Are really unique and really repay close study. And likewise with you, Will, and your work that you've shared on Vendée Radio and have been very well received by my listeners. It's a conversation that I've really enjoyed, and I think you bring great depths to all sorts of very important issues, which very few other commentators are willing to discuss. And when I raised the possibility of this topic with you in the last few weeks, I was very pleased that both our thoughts sort of corresponded with where we might take this topic, because again, I don't think it's something that many other commentators have really got a grip on, really. And there's a significant trend going on here that I think people would do well to just pause and make sure that they see the panorama with a supernatural logic, which is a phrase that a dear friend gave me, which I always bear in mind. You've mentioned that I've got a presentation. It's the beginnings of a presentation, but really they're just discussion points, and I'd really like to get your thoughts on them. So I'd like to begin really by just letting your listeners know about an event that occurred in England here on September the 11th, Armistice Day. I think for you it's Veterans Day or Armistice Day. I sometimes forget the distinction there. But this event occurred at a very important time of year for English national culture and what remains of the allegiance to the British nation state, which we'll come on to, but I believe was the form of political religion which obtained in Great Britain in the 19th century and into the 20th century, reaching its climax around the time of the World Wars, was both diminished but also vivified by the mass sacrifice of the two World Wars, was very much in the ambient culture in the immediate post-Second World War period, but has been in decline ever since the various revolutions of the 1960s, the sexual revolution, the cultural revolution. But nevertheless, among the older generations, the baby boomers, it still holds a real grip for non-Christians. And so that this particular commemoration of the end of the First World War is a time of national commemoration. And there is a sort of central ceremony at the Cenotaph, which is the main war memorial of London. And this coincided with a pro-Palestinian march, which has been going on very regularly. London's got a large Mohammedan population, so, and is, as most metropolises are, quite left-leaning. So there were expected to be thousands of people. And for a number of weeks prior to this coincidence of these two events, the mainstream media was very much amplifying the simultaneous events and stoking this sort of view that the Palestinian protest was going to somehow clash with the memorial at the Cenotaph. There was going to be some kind of desecration. And to be fair, there have been various people on these marches, whether they're agents provocateurs or ordinary civilians, I don't know, but who have desecrated and have graffitied war memorials and things like that with pro-Palestinian graffiti. But the actual threat of it was certainly played up, and there were several known Zionist agents, people like Douglas Murray and Tommy Robinson, who were really inflaming the situation. They saying they were urging their followers, the sort of civic nationalists, counter jihad folk, to go down to the Cenotaph and have a show of strength, show the pro-Palestinian protesters that, you know, we stand for Britain. And so you had this brewing conflict that was being clearly stoked and artificially exaggerated by various agents in a very obvious way. And what struck me about it actually in the lead up was that there was recognition of that, I think, from most distant writers who might be pulled into that dialectic, that this conflict, this artificial conflict between sort of national populist counter jihad movement and the pro-Palestinian movement could only really benefit one group, and that you could see that on kind of both sides. Indeed, you know, part of the pro-Palestinian group was the British Communist Party and the British Trotskyist movement, which has leaders from that same group. So there was a recognition there, so that on the actual day of the protests, which, and the Palestinian one was never even scheduled to go anywhere near the Cenotaph, there were some minor scuffles with so-called far-right protesters. Tommy Robinson was in the milieu. He hopped into a black cab taxi as soon as things started getting hot, and got out of there. So that was noted, which is helpful, I think, for people to realize who he works for. And there were just a small number of arrests. So I think what they were looking for, possibly something much more dramatic, more violent, maybe even leading to deaths, didn't occur. It wasn't a January 6th, which I think might have been what they were hoping for. And I chalk that up as something of a victory, of something of a success, really, because what it showed is that through the information networks on Twitter and people being aware of the duplicitous nature of these Zionist actors and being aware of their masters, they didn't fall for this sort of participation in egregore that they were trying to sell. So that was encouraging, and I think the more that sort of thing happens, the better. However, as we know, with regards to Judeo-Masonic power and the revolution against Christian civilization, the attack on the church, engineered apocalypticism, there is never just a plan A. There's always a plan B, a plan C, and we've got to be, as our Lord said, we've got to watch and pray. So this really brings me to the main area that I'd like to discuss with you, gentlemen, which is the growing, what's been termed the great noticing, which is the growing presence in public discourse, even percolating into fairly mainstream right-wing discourse, of Jewish involvement in various subversive movements, such as what gets termed woke, in fact, cultural Marxism. And of course, we had the Kanye West episode a few months ago or earlier this year, which I think really made this very vivid and stark, where I got sucked in at the beginning of it. I thought this was the real thing. I thought when he was showing the list of, you know, who owns the media with the red boxes, this was something that was outside Judeo-Masonic control. This really was a problem for them, that there was somebody really sticking up, you know, standing up and pointing the finger. But then within a few weeks, we had the infamous Alex Jones interview and the whole bizarre nature of that. And you spoke very well, I think, both of you, about the sort of the role of the Holy Fool. And I think we could see there something of how the sort of epistemic problem the synagogue might face through things like the internet. The fact that if you go on any, let's say, Yuval Noah Harari video on YouTube that allows comments, the top comments are going to be awareness of the JQ. That's just out there now. Comments underneath the World Economic Forum, you know, tweets about owning nothing and being happy. There'll be quotes from Voltaire. If you want to know who rules over you, look at who you're not allowed to criticize. These things are so recurrent within internet discourse, and I think so prominent among the Zoomers, millennials, younger generations, that it has to be managed by the synagogue. And I think we're starting to see how they're going to do that. So that's sort of my introduction, and I'd be interested if any of that resonates with your own thoughts.
Well, I'm going to kick it to Will, but before I do, let me say you laid that out beautifully. That we can chew on that for a long time. I'm not going to dig. I'll let Will start out, but we see it syncopation between a lot of Ivy League schools, you know, Harvard being one of them, events where these two things are colliding at the same time. Sometimes one might be organic and one, you know, what sticks out, especially in my mind, and Will will say this too, the event in Ireland. If you, Will sent me the interview on Will, Tim Kelly with the Irish reporter, and you get it once you hear that. It just falls in line with all the other events. And so we're talking about how managed can skewing, alchemically managed, skewing two very different stories come to achieve a particular kind of outlook, I think is what we're thinking about. And Will had a couple ideas.
Sure, yeah.
Before talking. And so, yeah, Will, if you want to go with that.
Sure. Yeah. Sorry to interrupt you there. Yeah, just sort of, as you said, as our Lord said, we have to be watchful and we have to pray. And part of being watchful is sort of taking in the panorama, painting this landscape and taking in the various stimuli and mixed signals that we're getting, the syncopation, as Doug was just saying, where you have, Doug has talked about in the past, epistemic communities. So this like centralizing myth that binds together, you know, an identity or a nation, a people. And Theo, you've also referred to it as the boomer truth regime that seems to be under attack or collapsing around this issue of Jewish exceptionalism within Western consciousness and the West's duty and role within maintaining that Jewish exceptionalism on the world stage and protecting Israel. So it's almost as though we're having our noses rubbed in the fact that atrocities are happening in Gaza and that we're allowed to critique them, but kind of not. And these sort of counter pivots that are taking place around the messaging around this issue. So, after you talked about Kanye West's externalization, and then more recently we've had within the Daily Wire this seeming kind of controversy and collapse of messaging around Ben Shapiro's, you know, unlimited support of Israel's right to protect itself. And, Candace Owens, Charlie Kirk, Matt Walsh stepping out of line and questioning why is this acceptable? And then why is there this double standard in which whiteness can be portrayed in certain ways and Jewishness cannot? And so all of the noticing seems to be funneling into this category of whiteness and white identity and protecting whiteness, and why is it permissible to constantly be denigrated within the spectacle. And likewise, when we turn on our television, we're just bombarded with images of mixed race and white characters playing the villains, and it's over the top that they want us to see that this is taking place, almost in a way to stir a kind of opposite reaction, a reverse causality. So it's sort of steering, funneling us in a direction by encouraging the opposite through this kind of dialectical tension. So, I think I'll leave it there for now and see what you guys have to say.
Yeah, I mean, before we hop over to Theo, and then there's also these controlled revelations. And a lot of this is organic. All of the critiques this week on the film, Leave the World Behind. A lot of the racial elements are there, apparently, predictive programming, and I guess another one on a civil war is coming. So the racial component is big, pushing everybody back into the whiteness. But yet at the same time, I think this is always part of the grab bag, like the Kennedy assassinations. We have a little bit of the mob over here and Cuba over here. It's the Russians, it's the Koreans, this clusterfuck of everything. So it's just an atmosphere of chaos around a pivotal dramatic event. And so there's a lot of things to think through. But I think where you guys are going more centrally, we can take it a different way. What are you seeing right now in terms of where the conversation is going as maybe the central pivot at this point, Theo?
Well, the concept that really, I think, helps me to get some kind of handle on what's going on here is that of, as Will's termed it, non-linear warfare, or as you've called it, menticidal non-linear warfare. That to relate those syncopated events of the sort of attempted false flag crisis event on November the 11th in London, and then these controlled revelations. What concerns me is that false flag in November 11th, we saw it coming. There was a response and it was actually muted. I don't think they got everything they wanted out of it, maybe. So that's quite satisfying in a way. What worries me is when something comes along from the synagogue that we didn't anticipate. And COVID was, I think, something like that. A virus was such a perfect thing. It was invisible. It could spread easily. You know, the whole, it separated people. It isolated them. So, of course, we're not going to be able to predict what the devil does and what his servants do. But I didn't see this coming, I think. The fact they would actually start talking about Jewish power explicitly. I thought they would do everything they could to obviate that. And for a long time, there's been a kind of maxim among not just Catholics, but sort of any dissident thinkers aware of the realities of oligarchy and monopolies and you know, centralized control, that any figure that wouldn't name the JQ was untrustworthy in some kind of way. But I don't think that fully applies now. I think that when you're getting guests on Tucker Carlson, for example, Colonel McGregor, who's saying things like, the reason why there is such animosity towards Russia in the US State Department is because there are a group of people in the State Department whose ancestors come from Russia and had bad experiences there. I mean, he's getting awfully close to naming the unnameable group. And I don't think that's by accident. And I think the fact that Charlie Kirk now, who, you know, just a few years ago was standing up there and you had the Nick Fuentes gropers coming out and was saying Israel's our greatest ally and batting away these questions about dancing Israelis, all very funny, but how controlled even was that? Was Nick Fuentes, you know, set up as the sort of, you know, the kind of edgy Zuma wing of this controlled noticing? And I'm starting to suspect that might be the case.
I'm sorry, Theo. I want to turn it back over to Will. Will and I were talking about that at the time, and I was kind of being generous. And I said, you know, maybe some of these people that are part of Shapiro's group are returning to their baptism, or I don't, you know. But in private, Will and I were saying they got the memo. And I could do so many characters, you know, within the Tucker Carlson wing, but I noticed online, and I almost hate the fact that I'm this engaged with the news, honestly, given the fact that, you know, I'm talking about the spectacle, but a name like Scott Ritter, who would always just, you know, come out of the blue and say, I always just loved Wizard, then just boom, not only just hate it, he's talking about the people that control you, and just 360 overnight. I just don't think people operate quite that way. And there's a number of cases of it. So it makes you kind of really wonder. One idea, and I want to get back because Will's got a few ideas here, but I almost hate saying this, you know, I mentioned it before, but the Albert Pike quote kind of does fit some of this. We don't know the authenticity of the true age of it, but the idea, even if this note is only like 75 years old, this idea, and here's where we go, that there's this level of sort of British imperialism, sort of this mixed class that operates even above the Hasids and so forth. And the true plan would be destroying everything, including it. Now, that's a tricky thesis, and I'm not necessarily suggesting it, but it does fit that at one time, the Israelis would be the broom, they say, of the synagogue to help, you know, usher in the clash between civilizations. Yet there would, and this has been predicted, and this is part of Talmudic Kabbalah, is that at least a third, there'd have to be another kind of revisit of this self-destruction on the synagogue itself. And that would be included, and maybe a decimation. And that could even be manufactured, like this return to woe to those still in Jerusalem on this day kind of thing. So there's a lot of things going around, but it does fit that the ultimate goal of having this initial manufactured headquarters in Jerusalem would be a wiping clean of everything at the satanic level to usher in a true age of Luciferianism. And in that sense, one could be that it's really everybody that's captured in it. Everybody, all parts are kind of captured into it. You're kind of accepting at that point that there's this idea the cabal really is a mixed group of true Luciferians that are moving every piece around. The one tricky part of that for me is I think a pivotal piece of this is the Noahide laws. And that's where you get the Masonic connection. Whether you're Anglo or Muslim, those Masonic 21st level people are going to be responsible for carrying out a lot of that part. And I didn't mean to put so many, I'm going to turn it over to you, Will, so you can maybe hone in on maybe too much whirly twirl that I put out there.
No, it was good. Thank you. The Islam is the broom of of the synagogue, I think, is that quote that seems to make so much sense in light of especially the Albert Pike World War III conspiracy prediction, apocalyptic prediction, which may or not be true, but seems to be heading in that direction for sure. And also I want to circle back to something Theo was talking about with lockstep. It seems like there's this strategy now to obfuscate the lockstep, where we had everyone stand, pulling out all the stops, every media outlet, every voice in the mainstream was all, reiterating the legitimacy of the COVID pandemic and protocols and everything that needed to take place here. And so now it seems like to blur, like there's too much knowledge about, Jewish influence over that regime, that now it's an attempt to obfuscate the fact that Jewish power is orchestrating all of these tensions and controversies that are taking place now. So a way to do that is to have people who have been, univocally in support of Israel and Jewish agenda to come out and critique it. And then, like Elon Musk is someone else we haven't mentioned in the whole changeover of Twitter, and how one day he's touring Israel with Benjamin Netanyahu. The next day he's telling the CEO of Disney that he can go enjoy himself. And what do we make of that, other than it's kind of a covering of the tracks, is what I would take it to be. Likewise, RFK Jr. is now just full bore Zionist, jingoist, no questions asked, tool of the Chabad movement. I think he said something this week about how Palestine is the most what was the term he used? Coddled or most overprivileged nation in the international community because of all the support that they get. And he made the statement, I think maybe 6 months ago, on a campaign where he said something about how the virus was genetically engineered to not affect Ashkenazis or something like that. And then the next week he was out marching with the head Chabad rabbi of New York. And since then, now he's just full support of Israel. No questions about the assassination of his father and uncle. But anyway, I think that's a way of, he was such a vocal critic of the COVID agenda, and then now he's circled back to where he's fully in support of those. And likewise, you could say the same thing about, the JFK, RFK assassinations. It's a good way of, getting him on board in order to conceal that lockstep of who's driving this messianic agenda, and using, instigating tensions toward sort of mutual destruction. And maybe if there is, there's not something like, like the protocols or like the third world war prophecy of Albert Pike are not completely true, they still contain a kernel of truth in the sense that it's about harnessing conflicts toward the mutual destruction of the existing order in order to forge through to the next, so that those who are standing outside can pick up the pieces.
And before I go to you, Theo, I want to just say really quickly, I think that's a good observation to pivot from, is how controlled the march step was during the pandemic. And now it's almost deliberately kind of loosened. I think it's reasonable to think that there's some controlled chaos here, contained chaos that's allowed. When I always mention in my book, I say the World Economic Forum and their controlled opposition, that's already built into it. And this is where we get the, I think, slow engineering to the right now. So I think there's a moment of chaos, and it's going to kind of take their plan to operate or move forward in the right. One of the indications of that is the premier now of Argentina, just completely this right-wing kind of controlled person. Somebody that's doing good work on this right now is Days of Noah, and looking how that right wing is going to really get the when the messages comes more in sync, it's going to be about bio digital convergence, and that's why Elon Musk and his Neuralink is going to be more acceptable, the merging of currencies, and that's going to take place, I think, under a little bit more of a reaction to the World Economic Forum, to some extent a controlled reaction, and then moving in to have the right wing again at least these kind of controlled voices, always in the line of Zionism. So there's, I think there's voices that are out there allowed to kind of say this. The whole idea that Elon Musk, and this guy is such an agent upon an agent, you know, the idea that he's the savior of X and going to bring the free voice to the world. But it's just a time of mass confusion. And so I think what we're doing here is just trying to maybe step back and pick some larger patterns out of all this. Theo, what do you make of all of that?
Yes, well, would a President Hillary Clinton have been able to convince most Americans to get an experimental mRNA injection?
No.
There's no. Trump's purpose for yes. or one of yes. them.
Warp so, speed. Yeah. And the acceptance of medical martial law.
Yeah. So there are meta political purposes to the Great Awakening, this umbrella term for this surge on the right. It has an interesting intersection with Eurasianism and the behemoth apocalyptic beast. That's maybe another subject. But I think it's worth saying that, as you say, the coordinated, the synchronized nature of certain talking points and emerging into the stratosphere and right-wing politics and media, for me, is always an indicator that there's some kind of orchestration and manipulation going on. These characters, when you look into it, often have part of the same talent agencies, and there are lots of behind the scenes there. I would love it. I would love to be able to say that someone like Candace Owens, Charlie Kirk, Matt Knowles, as you say, I would love to be able to say that they are perhaps, recalling their baptism, reviving their baptismal graces and really deciding to speak the truth in the public square. If they were coming out and saying, listen, there is serious Jewish historic subversion, and from what we can see, it's all targeted towards Christian civilization and towards even just Christianity in general. Yes. Then I might start to think that. But where we're seeing them take this is that this is targeted at whites, or this is targeted at Americans. And that's where you think there is some kind of play going on here. There's some...
All the dots come together on what you just said. That's where all the dots, and you can kind of bring it together and hint and dance around it. And that's my issue with the trad community right now. I mean, you just said it.
So the concept of safety valve is critical here, because yes. there is just this reality of the reveal, conceal, nature of the JQ, which is engineered and is just rising in consciousness among the younger generations. It has to be channeled and it has to be manipulated yes. and taken yeah. in a distorted direction. And I want to submit that the white is a category of empire and is thus containable for the regime ultimately.
Yes, absolutely. And Will and I we shared some of the same information that you had this year. The reporter from Ireland happened to mention that in her talk with Kelly, and the deracitation of identity within the subgroups that made up Christendom, to be able to both deconstruct that and reconstruct that in a desirable direction. Will, what do you want to get to right now?
Yeah, this is something that's coming up a lot in like some of the comment sections in these videos we're doing about, the race, ethnicity being under attack. And, I think there's some pushback. Some of our viewers watching this are certainly sort of cringing right now, I think, because they're working under a paradigm that it is an attack upon the race and racial identity and racial communities, and the culture is downstream of race. And that's what we have to preserve, and that has to be our starting point in order to reclaim any sense of like Western civilization. So I wanted to read a few comments and responses that Theo has said recently that I thought were particularly poignant. So this one, he's responding to someone who's talking about, you know, our misunderstanding of National Socialism. And obviously there's a lot of sort of pro people of that ideology who see that as the answer to sort of what's taking place. And let me read this without further ado. The evils of liberalism and communism do not exonerate or improve the evils of National Socialism and fascism. These are all wicked modern volunteerist ideologies downstream from the godless French Revolution. And then he quotes from Pope Pius X's Mit Brenadier Sorge. Whoever exalts race or the people or the state or a particular form of the state or the repositories of power or any other fundamental value of the human community, however necessary and honorable be their function in worldly things, whoever raises these notions above their standard value and divinizes them to an idolatrous level, distorts and perverts an order of the world planned and created by God. He is far from the true faith in God and from the concept of life, which faith upholds. And I think this is very similar to what Doug has talked about in Pursuit of the Metaverse as a political religion or an egregore, a second reality that omits a fundamental piece of reality and then becomes sort of parasitic and becomes pathological. So that the idea of the race or the state or the nation or the ethnicity becomes stripped away from the integral order that balances it and puts it within, you know, the mystical body. And then it becomes its own sort of monstrous Frankenstein golem that is trying to resolve the tensions in reality through this historical movement toward, you know, a fantasy of the future. And I think that's what's happening within all political religions. And that's the doom fate of ethno-nationalism. It's always going to be instrumentalized by Jewish power. A quote that Theo has shared with me before from The Jewish Century by Yuri, I always butcher this name, Schleskine. Is that correct, Theo?
Yeah, Schleskine.
Schleskine. He says, nationalism meant that every nation has to become Jewish. Every single one of them had been wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities. Every people was chosen, every land promised, every capital Jerusalem. Christians who give up trying to love their neighbors as themselves because they had finally discovered who they were, French, Flemish, Swedish. They were like Jews in that they loved themselves as a matter of faith and had no use for miracles. So nationalism could also be extended to identity politics and ethnic identities being pitted against one another and into these kind of tensions. At the same time, we have this kind of white ethno blob of love that's emerging in which all different forms of European consciousness are being funneled into this sort of homogeneity of whiteness. The counter to that of trying to say, well, I'm, you know, Norman or I'm Scottish or whatever, like those can still be instrumentalized in the same way. And without the sense of like a hierarchical structure of the integral order, balancing all these things and creating a sense of a transcendent reality, it's just a naturalistic solution to a supernatural problem.
That was nice, Will. That was nice. I'm going to turn it over to Theo. I've not that I'm being all pluggy today, but I just want to keep something really simple and dynamic. It kind of hit me yesterday. In the work, Seeing Through the Singularity, I told a story yesterday about when I was sort of had my conversion experience. I was sort of graced with being able to see patterns in scripture and at the same time seeing patterns in Talmudic Kabbalah. And so what I did is juxtapose the Christian singularity, which is pretty much this many verses that lead to the hypostatic union where we're attached to the mystical body of Christ. And this is the counterfeit version of it, is the singularity. It's the techno singularity. Sometimes it's attached to the techno serpent in Kabbalah. I think the most potent form of getting to the artificial singularity, the techno singularity, the political arm of that is Zionism. And in the pursuit of the metaverse, what I'm doing is, I think what this is, it's more visual book. And one of the parts I really like about it, and Will and I talk about this, what we really discovered is the role in medieval society and the integrated world of the icon. And that's where we really bring both the Eastern Orthodox and Roman tradition together, and identifying that that was the key visual set. And so what the Christian tradition is, it's the beatific vision, something we sort of see with our mind's eye, and we're driven for this kingdom. And the metaverse in this sense is the visual substitution. In both cases, the singularity, we're kind of plugged in artificially to this network of all things. And likewise, there's a similarity, but it's this artificial, immanentized version of the beatific vision. And I don't know why I felt like putting that in there, but the more Will and I talk about this, we were just blinded by this. Like so many times as America, you know, and I teach this stuff, the world starts in 1776, everything before that must have been at somehow faulty. And I think it's the most disguised thing in the world that in spiritual terms, the Great Commission was for Christ said, go out and baptize all nations, create a Christian empire. And this integral order was actually achieved. And it's so amazing. And it's right in front of us, but we don't have the eyes to see it. Now, can we return to that order? Well, we could talk about that. Like what you do, what do you do with this information? Like what, you know, what are y'all talking about? Where's all this going? What do you do with this? And individually, I think it's helpful in returning to our baptism or identifying our baptism and walking in Christ toward the beatific vision. But what do we do with it collectively? It does get a little bit tricky. I don't hear anybody else out there saying great answers. One thing I tend to believe in my heart of hearts is one solution is to return. This sounds corny. Is to return to the strongest element of that, which is, of course, Catholic ecclesiology, the Catholic liturgy centered upon the Eucharist. But I think represented, and if people could become unified in the traditional Latin Mass. And I know that sounds like the last place you'd think, unless you're talking about some, oh, you know, rad trads regurgitating the same old thing. It is truly, we have to integrate our consciousness before we can talk about building a new collective order. And I just think that's the linchpin from the past. It's there's a continuity with it. And I think it holds the greatest promise for the way that we go about thinking through going into the future amongst all this confusion and chaos that's in our midst. And I didn't mean to be too self-promoting there. I couldn't help myself. I'm going to go back to you, Theo. It's your show today.
So from one plug to another, one of the authors that you cite frequently in Pursuit of the Metaverse is Father Dennis Fahey. And I'd like to quote from him now. He writes, "Thus, when any nation turns against the supernatural Messiah, it will be pulled in the direction of subjection to the natural Messiah, Antichrist. Even Hitler and Rosenberg, with their deification of the German race and their campaign against the supernatural life, which comes from the true Messiah, are in the last resort, owing to the superiority of Jewish organization, only preparing the way for the new ruler who will put Israel über alles. Satan has a wide view of things. He will be quite prepared to utilize the naturalism of Hitler and Rosenberg, to the formation of which Prussian Freemasonry and the philosophy of Kant, Fichte, and Hegel have so powerfully contributed against our divine Lord. There is laughter in hell when human beings succumb once more to the temptation of the Garden of Eden and put themselves in the place of God, whether the new divinity be the Jewish race or the German race." End quote. So I want to point out here to listeners that there is a half-truth to this egregore of sort of ethnic pride. And that is that, as you just said, Doug, God wills the nations, and the nations are a reality, a divine reality, if you will. The nations have guardian angels, and they really are families of families, we might think of them as. Okay, so the nation is a reality. And in our last conversation, Will, on Vendée Radio, we talked about the imposition of Jewish categories as being a major leitmotif of modernity. So I would submit again that white is one of those unhelpful categories, to say the very least. Nation is a real category. White is a category of empire. It's a Darwinian category. So in submitting to it, one automatically, well, almost automatically presupposes Darwinism, molecules to man evolution, which is a hoax. And one also, I think the usefulness, the utility of it for the synagogue is that it is a form of camouflage whereby the Jew disappears. Are Jews white? It clouds the issue. It makes it very difficult. In fact, going further back, the fringes of the Republican Party, it seems, various political operators have been playing footsie with various ethno-nationalists. We've talked before about, and various guests on my podcast, particularly Jesse Russell, have talked about how Stephen Bannon has been in charge of this sort of outreach to the alt-right, and how there was a purposeful sort of collaboration with figures like Richard Spencer and ethno-nationalists leading up to the 2016 election. He claimed that they were trying to sort of harness their energy, and I think there's something to that. It's kind of maybe some form of chaos magic. But also there was a realization there again that this was where the next generation could be recuperated back into the Republican Party and thus back into the empire. Stephen Miller, one of Trump's, you know, members of the Trump's administration, who is Jewish, but also white nationalist, it would seem, adjacent at least, again, is, I think, within this milieu. You look at various prominent white nationalist organizations like the American Renaissance, Greg Johnson, Countercurrents. So many of them have both Jewish and homosexual founders and backers. So I don't think that's by accident. And I think that collaboration has never really gone away. The major figure at the moment, I would suppose, is Nick Fuentes, who had America First Congress or a convention to which Marjorie Taylor Greene attended. Now, there's no way that she would attend without a thorough background check of who this person is. I think they're part of the same political machine, and that there is this a plausible deniability that goes on. It's part of the footsie, but nevertheless, there is outreach to this milieu. And this milieu talks about Jewish power explicitly, but as being motivated by anti-white enmity, not as anti-Christ enmity. So it fulfills various useful functions in that regard. The category of white, so there is a truth. The truth is this, that by whatever mystery of divine providence, Europe is the place where the seed of the gospel took root and infused and formed Europe's deep bone structure in the way that it did nowhere else. The Middle East was once Catholic. For whatever reason, God allowed that to be swept away by Mohammedanism. There were many Christian churches in the East going into Central Asia, even India. But Europe was where the gospel was accepted, took root. The pearl of great price was put at the heart of civilization. And the Augustinian project for putting the holy sacrifice at the Mass at the center, the heart of the social order was actually established. The European peoples are physically white, yes. So if you're talking about Europeans, I think that's a more helpful category. I think that is a real category. But white, again, is deracinated. Where does it come from? It comes, I think, from being defined against black or against colored. It comes from chattel slavery in the United States, where the, you know, Africans were brought in as slaves. Europeans were increasingly categorized as whites by state governments in the South, and then increasingly by the federal government. It's quite an interesting little side note. The Jewish figures within the Confederacy, figures like Judah P. Benjamin, the head of the Confederate Intelligence Services, obviously Jewish involvement in the slave trade is very prominent. So this dialectic between white and black has always been there bubbling away. It's very useful for synagogue power when you look at the collaboration with black nationalist movements, but then also with white nationalist movements, the old divide and conquer technique. And I look back to, as was shared in that video, that white as a federal category was introduced in 1914 by, I would say, probably one of the worst presidents that America has ever had, Woodrow Wilson, for both for establishing the Federal Reserve and the enthronement of the money power, for destroying the last anointed Catholic monarchy in the world with the Habsburg Empire, the remaking Europe in the image of America with the so-called democratic nation states, one disaster after another. A lesser known one is that in 1914, he established segregation in the federal workforce, white and black. In 1964, you had a president from the same political party desegregating the federal workforce, desegregating the United States with the Civil Rights Act, and bringing forth this very problematic, damaging idea of difference in treatment before the law, which is anathema to the common law tradition itself. Presidents from the same party, both adhering ostensibly to the US Constitution. It shows how elastic that document can be made by the oligarchs. So by rallying to the standard of white, you are rallying to the standard of a category invented by the American Empire and for the American Empire. It is containable, I would submit. So yes to recognizing the providential mission of the European peoples, even a mission of leadership. The Europeans were charged by God, I believe, to, just as Christopher Columbus was sponsored by the Catholic monarchs of Spain, to evangelize the peoples, the colored peoples of the world. Yes, and to that extent, Europe has a role as being a model. And I think there is an anti-European animosity that comes from an inchoate realization that Europe has apostatized, that the discipled nations of Christendom have thrown away the pearl of great price. And there's a kind of visceral disgust from many colored people at the kind of the perfidy that demonstrates. So that's weaponized as well. So this is a problem. It gets synthesized with nationalism. That's a whole nother topic or a whole nother area you can talk about, but it's a mobilization of this old religion, this old political religion against the left wing. It fulfills lots of functions. It's useful for garnering sympathy for Zionism, for Jewish nationalism. And it's a stirring up of loyalties to the old gods. It's another mind prison. Ultimately, it is containable for the regime. And it is, I think, in origin from the synagogue.
Wow. That was really good, Theo. I liked that. That was really good. I just want to make a couple quick comments. I'm going to put it back to Will. Marjorie Taylor Greene, is that how you say that? I mean, I teach policy. I don't even watch this stuff. I watched a video with her and Tucker, and I know who she's kind of supposed to be. And they were playing the footsie thing. Like they were talking about taking the oath, but they didn't say to who, once you get in Congress. And then they were talking about the special interests, but the old hack about bow to my constituents and not the special interests, and everybody kind of, but they didn't say who they were. And then on the other side, she'll go and make these friends that are more explicit about it. So playing with that, like you said, that innuendo. And I thought that's a pivotal or an interesting character that kind of brings some of these pieces together. And he's there, with the Tucker Carlson face, another thing to add to your thesis about white people, there was a book, I think it's from the 1980s, called When the Irish Became White, because in the American experience, people held on to that Anglo identity. And essentially what you're getting to, when they became useful for empire, is essentially what it's really saying. It's not that the Irish themselves, we're finally white and we're not, that was the subtext to it. And finally, I think weaved into a lot of those parts that this was going to be a certain kind of ethno empire. Woodrow Wilson, in one sense, signals so many things with the death of, really essentially, it's the death of the Victorian age. And I think within the death of the Victorian age, are a certain set of values unique to the English experience. And they might have continued on and had a slow death. And some of these events that you're taking place are probably, like today, are probably pulling from that in order to rework them in some ways from the fumes of that. But yes, I think all those parts, essentially what it is, it's full throttled modernity, for lack of a better word. And with that idea, it's the blurring of this concept, this created concept called, I believe, whiteness. Now, people, this is probably triggering stuff for, you know, people. What else do you want to do right now? Like, how else do you, you know, yeah, we don't have much to work with. It's hard to go back, and it's hard for me to rediscover my Scandinavian roots, frankly. You know, how, what do you do with that, especially as an American? But I think part of the idea you're getting from is this sort of American virus where everything's deracitated has now been exported to the rest of the world. So it's really a deracitated, and how it's camouflaged is within concepts of whiteness. And of course, you know, blacks that came from many different areas of Africa have to accept the shade of blackness. So it's a way to, it's making us malleable as part of the tools of empire, I believe. Will, what do you got?
Yeah. And, you know, I think there's a tendency to lay this all at the feet of America as being this model for a nation of immigrants, a nation of nations, a mixed multitude that's fully deracinated. And, but it isn't like us Americans got together and said, okay, we want the Walgreens over here and we want the Walmart over here and the McDonald's over here. This was plopped on us. You know, this was something that we had no stake in. You can say you vote with your footsteps and with your dollars, but, you know, we all have limited means and we have to do the best that we can. And so we've inherited this culture. And so trying to, you know, lay out the landscape, view reality as it's before us, as accurately as we can, we have to kind of trace out, you know, how did America come to be this great exporter of you know, liberalism and the collapse of the European European civilization. So
yeah, I want to slice this in right now. It just popped in my head, and it's not very cool for me to slice this in. But Rene Girard, this just hit me. We think in such either or categories, good or bad. Everything is always both. You know, and I think when we do that and talk about America or the empire, you know, it's a healthy way to think about these kind of terms, is that we're getting both with these ideas, really with everything. I mean, yes, there is evil in the world and there is good. But when we talk about these things, they come together and paired. And that's kind of there's a mystery there. But I'm sorry, Will, go ahead.
Yeah. And, you know, Francis Bacon's New Atlantis model is a bastardization of, you know, the idea of Christendom made secular and spread throughout the world. And that comes about, I think, to go back to one of the things Theo was saying about, you know, the pearls of Europe and these nations that were, you know, had their own archangels that governed over them and were pointed toward the transcendent idea of Catholic society. Once they apostatized, they became ripe for infection through millennial Jewish dreams. And that's exactly what took place in Britain during the English Civil War. And I want to point to a really terrific chapter in Pursuit of the Metaverse called Puritan Paradise. And this particular moment in the mid 17th century during the English Civil War, where we have the appearance of the Cartwright petition and this letter by Manasseh ben Israel, written under a pseudonym, Nicholas Edward, I think, in which he's advocating for the readmission of Jews into England so that England can achieve its national mission as a chosen people to liberate and be the protectors of the true Old Testament chosen people. So there's this sort of, allegiance that takes place within the nation. And its election is contingent upon its bowing to Jewish election. So I'm gonna read this little excerpt here from page 355. Sons of Israel, the War Council's reception of the Cartwright petition in January 1649 was followed by the publication in London of another notable pamphlet, an apology for the notable nation of the Jews and all the sons of Israel, bearing the name Edward Nicholas. And this was Manasseh ben Israel, who was a Jewish Kabbalist, rabbi, very important political thinker of the time. The pamphlet deserves a close reading as we consider its political application to the Zionocentric tradition. The basic argument of the apology is that to properly love God and enjoy God's blessings, a nation must honor and assist Jews, God's chosen people. In agreement with the Cartwright petition, the apology suggests that Jews would best be honored by readmitting them to England and eventually helping them regain control of Palestine. The strict Is Palestine ever really a place, guys, just as an aside? Or is it ever true? Does Palestine ever existed? Or is that just a fake place? But anyway.
A lot of people pulled up a coin that said Palestine in 1917, if that's a quick visual go-to. But I know what you're playing with.
The strict and cruel laws now in force against the most honorable nation of the world, the nation of the Jews, a people chosen by God, are a sin. This rejection of Jews has highly incensed the majesty of Jehovah, when England should rather to honor them whom God honoreth. The new millennial and messianic political religion now transitions into an apology for English empire and an evocation of the egregore of New Jerusalem, or to frame it in Kabbalistic terms, the kernel of Zionism became enveloped in the Edomic husk of British imperialism. The document insists that while other nations persecute Jews, England's national vocation is clear. I hope better things for our nation when our troubles at home by God's mercy are composed. There are many gallant men now in arms and others that may be instrumental in beating down God's enemies and the enemies of his people. The apology then proposes that protecting Jews should be the central concern for English foreign policy once the Civil War concludes. So this apostate mission that is now, you know, smuggled into British identity first appears as a religious mission, but it quickly becomes an economic enterprise because the kickbacks and the benefits of inviting in usury allowed the British Empire to expand greatly, and then that becomes the impetus for the Puritans who come to the New World and to the English colonies to set up these sort of strongholds of this imperial vision. And then that is what launches into the American empire that extends this, messianic mission throughout the world. So, when you talk about the year zero of 1776, we could also extend that back to the year zero of the Protestant Revolution, which now says, oh, everything that came before the last, 1500 years of Christian civilization, they're meaningless. That's all just a persecution of God's chosen people. And now we have to bring back the true mission of Christianity. And it always comes in under the guise of, well, this is the missing piece that will cause the conversion of the Jews. And then that becomes, well, we're actually converting ourselves into their Jewish dream of a millennial kingdom to come.
Yeah. And again, you're going to have Carl Schmitt's state of exception happening there, where a new alignment of friend-foe distinctions, and the papacy and all Catholics are considered evil now. And that's part of building an earthly kingdom. It requires that the new foe is pitted against Catholicism and papacy. Theo, any thoughts?
Yeah, I think many... It would be to adopt the very same revolutionary spirit, the fire in the minds of men, as James Billington calls it, to say America is not just an ill-founded republic, but is irrecuperable. That somehow there needs to be a year, like a Catholic year zero, where everything must be obliterated and start from scratch. That's not how our Lord's, the mission of the church, the Christianizing mission of the church takes place. Of course, that's not what happened to the pagan Roman Empire. Pagan Roman Empire was baptized, which presupposes that the natural subject remains, but is infused and lifted into supernature. And so it is not to say that, in a future Catholic United States, there will be no July the 4th fireworks or whatever. It'll be that those fireworks are for Our Lady of Guadalupe on December 12th. And there will be, through God's providence, he has allowed this. I appreciate and I sympathize that as an Englishman, I have to do something of the same sort of historical excavation to dig through the layers, the black legends, to find the true England, which is Catholic England. And it's easier for me because England really is a nation. It is a family of families. There is a true ethnicity there, whereas America is a sort of mosaic of nations. But even there, one must be aware that a Yorkshireman ethnically is mostly Scandinavian. And whereas a man from Cumbria is perhaps mostly Celtic. But through the vicissitudes of history, through the providence of God's of, you know, God's order of providence as it has eventuated, they have been fused or they have been integrated into an English story, an English Catholic history. And so I would say, you know, as a consolation to American listeners, while it might not be as easy as it is for us Europeans in the old world to recover our true national identity, our national form, that doesn't mean that for Americans, there's no hope. In fact, I would point to the consolation that Alexis de Tocqueville gives in Democracy in America, that famous remark where he says that the inner logic of the US Constitution is driving Americans in two directions. I can quote, he said that America is the most democratic country in the world, and at the same time, it is the country in which the Roman Catholic religion makes the most progress. Men living in democratic ages are very prone to shake off all religious authority. But if they consent to subject themselves to any authority of this kind, they choose that it should be single and uniform. Religious powers not radiating from a common center are naturally repugnant to their minds. The men of our day are naturally disposed to believe, but as soon as they any religion, they immediately find in themselves a latent desire which urges them unconsciously towards Catholicism. Many of the doctrines and practices of the Roman Catholic Church astonish them, but they feel a secret admiration for its discipline. Its great unity attracts them. Our posterity will tend more and more to a single division in two parts, some relinquishing Christianity entirely and others returning to the bosom of the Catholic Church.
That is from Democracy in America?
Yes.
I thought I'd read every word in there. I guess maybe the special emphasis, that was really good. And that's such a, what Jard's saying is that Tocqueville could always see the good and the bad in every point. He said, there's a destruction of a certain type of hierarchy, a certain type of divine order. But at the same time, he didn't think this unattainable equality, he had a sort of sense of charity and optimism about how he viewed that. And this contradiction between liberty and equality, he could sort of hold that together in his own mind when he looked at the pivot of the Constitution. But that bit about Catholicism, I guess I've missed that there's this secret, because I could say that as a Protestant, I think it's there, it's difficult to unearth, but once the crevices are there and people, that's why they never explore the apologetics, because they can never get there. But once they do, that's exactly what starts bubbling up. That was wonderful. I'd never heard that before. What do you think, Will? I'm sorry. Go ahead, Theo.
Well, to say that, as we know from salvation history, in God's grace and God's providence, his goodness doesn't just neutralize evil or blot it out, it surpasses it. So this is the felix culpa, the happy fault that is the Masonic United States of America. It is horrific that this was the first nation, European nation, to explicitly quite openly be officially indifferent to the incarnation of the second person of the Trinity in its establishment with religious indifferentism. That's a horror. But through God's providence, something greater, I think, that de Tocqueville is pointing to there follows. And I think we see it in our own time. I think that we do see, there's a reason why traditional Catholicism is perhaps most vibrant in the United States. It is where the scepter of the West is at the moment, for good or for ill. In God's providence, that's where it is. And we know from Talmudic and rabbinic literature that the enemy is always Rome. And that imperial scepter is in the United States, badly exercised, as we know. But nevertheless, that is where, in a certain sense, Rome is now. And not to be too Anglo-centric, but that is where so much traditional discourse and debates within the Catholic sphere is taking place. And I think that is for a reason. America is both in the vanguard of modernity and in the vanguard of God's solution to it.
Yeah. Yeah, the Anglo sphere, it seems to be the real influencers. I don't know if it's just the English speaking part or the cultural historical thrust behind it. A comment about Tocqueville, again, saying that he could see in his love for aristocracy and the old order, the old regime, but he could identify these things. And one thing, you know, it was duplicitous how there was kind of a hint of a natural law in 1776 with the Declaration, but there was no mention of God other than in the year of our Lord and the U.S. Constitution. And you could see what happened in between that is really, one writer called it the conspiracy in Philadelphia. But Tocqueville could identify in the new Constitution, when the states were in that midterm, the states had the option of revising the state church. They could be Anglican, they could be Methodist, they could be Presbyterian in that period between 1776 and 1789. And what Tocqueville recognized is that competition, that the preacher down the road had to heat it up and so forth. And even that early date in the 1820s, Tocqueville could identify with the state churches in Europe where things were, he could even identify the dying of the faith or the lessening of the essence of the Eucharist. And he could see that at least there was a fire in the belly between the preachers and he had to outpreach the Presbyterian or so forth. And that today is what we call the Bible Belt. And from my experiences hopping around and going to Novus Ordo Catholic masses, East, at least in the Bible Belt, you go to a Catholic mass and you can feel the spirit there. And so even within that milieu, there's a vibrancy and Tocqueville could appreciate that. You would think that he'd be all snobby and these, you know, rude Protestants and stuff like that. He really could appreciate the energy and the spirituality and the vigor of Protestantism. I mean, he was of mixed minds about it, of course, and he thought it was a great dissent and he wasn't going to sit there and scrutinize sola scriptura and sola fide, but he saw it in its raw sense. He saw a certain value there. I'm going to, unless you have something to say, Theo, I'm going to pop over to you, Will.
Oh, I was just thinking, since the Catholic social ideal is so contrary to American constitutionalism, could that be, this is just a question for both of you, why, you know, in the 1950s and 60s, there was this attempt to fuse, you know, the American empire with this kind of new, this new Catholicism, the Vatican II, to spread throughout the world and to kind of subdue that tension that you're talking about that brings an appetite for a traditional society.
Well, I'll throw that to, that's more in Theo's ballpark, but it's definitely, they were seated much earlier, but you see the seating of the ecumenical church that would be the New World Order church, I believe, or melded into the New World Order church in my suspicious kind of interpretation of that. But what do you think, Theo?
Well, I think it was Charles Coulomb who said that one way of seeing Vatican II is the American captivity of the church.
Wow.
And that has two layers of meaning. So on the prosaic, temporal, cratological level, we have CIA documents on the death of Pope Pius XII saying the next communiques, this is from David Wemhoff's book. He has the sources, saying that the next pope will be Roncalli, and after that it will be Montini.
Wow.
Now, does the CIA have a direct line to the Holy Ghost? I don't want to be flippant, but how do they know that? That is a manifestation of American power. The reality of the Second World War is the triumph of the American empire. And so there is a real sense in which, through all sorts of things, the infiltration of various agents, people like Malachi Martin and these various figures who did their utmost, particularly with the Council of the Media, as it's been called, to exert pressure on the Council Fathers to give this Americanist flavor to, particularly to Dignitatis Humanae. John Courtney Murray was crucial in that. The notes that were appended in the Abbott translation of the Council documents, distorting them in an Americanist direction. So you have that, and this is a whole, this could be a whole other show, but the way that Ronald Reagan and John Paul II made an alliance that ultimately, as E. Michael Jones said, was bad for the Catholic Church and it was bad for the United States. But the American state has become the model of the state that the Church proposes and supports to the world, which has been lethal. So there's that. There's also, and that speaks to the second layer of American captivity, which is this ideological captivity by liberalism. When Pope Benedict said in his 2005 Christmas address to the Curia that what we realized at the Council was that the American Revolution was different, that there was a reconcilable form of the Enlightenment, the moderate Enlightenment, if you will, in the United States, that the American Revolution was different to the French Revolution. And so that became, with under the auspices of American real political might in the 1960s, the political model that the Church would uphold. And we've seen that continue to be the case, even though is slightly fraying. So that in itself is I think a grievous blow to the Church. And insofar as American thinkers are prominent in identifying that, as someone like David Wemhoff is, E. Michael Jones, but also some integralist thinkers who are starting to see the errors of Americanism and how they've infected the universal Church, that's very healthy. Again, the debate that's being had here is very prominent in America. I think that's providential.
That's fantastic. Yeah.
That was good.
I don't want to take up too much of your evening here, Theo. You've been very generous. This has been terrific and really enjoyed it. And unless you have any more segments to present, I'd like to maybe transition to just something in closing, if you'd like.
Just some closing remarks then. Doug, you mentioned, what do Catholics then do? What do Catholics who are sensitive to realities like the Great Replacement? There really is an effort to completely submerge and dilute the realities of the European nations. I don't deny that at all. We just shouldn't take the reaction of ricocheting into white identity politics in response. So what do? I think, first of all, we love our countries in a true sense. So there is a truth within nationalism, which is patriotism. And that is loving the country itself. And that is desiring for it to be Catholic, which is for it to be truly itself. Wow. That America will be truly itself when Christ is enthroned. And that means that we have to distinguish between the country and the machinery of the state. So by all means, love motherhood and apple pie and baseball, but don't love the 17 intelligence agencies and necessarily believe that it is America when a Chinese spy balloon is apparently floating over the United States. Try and distinguish the apparatus of the oligarchy from the actual nation. And it's difficult, but to do one's best to do that, to be vigilant and guard against manipulation and be wary of this nationalist versus globalist dialectic. And be aware that white is itself a globalist category, because already it presumes the dissolution of real categories like being a Texan, being a Kentuckian, being of Scandinavian descent, being of English descent. These are realities. And in adopting whiteness, it is to really fall for a diminution, to say the least, and very much a modernist category.
Wow, that was good, Theo. You know, so I finish my book with that idea, the seeds that Father Fahey was planting about the social kingship of Christ. It's present, it's an ontological reality, regardless of the mechanics of the social orbit that we find ourselves in. So we have to be aware of that, but we have to be discerning, like you said. And you know, some person could be kind of, if somebody like Marshall Taylor, God bless him, you know, was going to run a political party called the Social Kingship of Christ, and essentially it's just going to be a wing of the Republican Party, you can kind of guess where that's going to go. But yes, I think that's exactly what Father Fahey was driving at. It is an ontological reality. Use the reality of the neighborhoods, the communities, the world we find ourselves in, and strive for that as an ideal. I think that's an excellent way to sort of wind this down. Will Tucker, what are you thinking over this?
Well, we said we might present this, and I could cut this out if you like, but just to talk about assessing reality as it is and hoping for things within that ontological reality. We also have to see simultaneously that it's not necessarily whiteness that's under attack, but our access to understanding the landscape as it is. So something that Theo pointed out recently that I haven't heard anyone else say is that in the midst of the recent controversy about the papal document that is endorsing same-sex blessings, or is it not? Pope Francis has also made a comment nearly the same day about the atrocities in Gaza by the IDF and killings of Christian civilians. So it seems as though there is an attempt to unroll this attack on the sacramental order of reality simultaneous with an admission of something that's an uncomfortable reality that most everyone else is not willing to address within, you know, the mainstream. So I'd just like, maybe if we have a second, to try to toss that idea around about what's going on there, if you all have a few more moments.
Absolutely. Well, I think we've all become so sadly habituated to the psychodrama of the Bergoglian menticide that it's really difficult to place the gravity of various doctrinal subversions and deviations comparatively with each other. But I think just what struck me in the last 48 hours is the extent to which the, let's say, counter Francis, of the trad-servative recognize and resist opposition to Francis's program, the way that they've been reacting to this latest horror is much stronger actually than I might have anticipated, and very much. I'm thinking people like Ashenden, G. Ashenden, people can look up, but his remarks about how this is a kind of a line in the sand that's been crossed. This is really the emergence of the anti-church, and the rhetoric is just so much stronger. Now, I'm not necessarily passing comment at the moment about whether that's true or not, the analysis that these figures are offering. I'm just remarking on the sort of, again, the synchronization of many of them saying it at once. And I think, if you look at things like communion for the divorced and remarried, which has been affirmed by an actual act, the Apostolic See, the infamous letter of Bergoglio to the Argentine bishop saying that their heretical implementation of Amoris Laetitia was the only way to understand that document. We've already seen blatant heterodoxy from this pontificate in this regard. So why is it now? And this just got me thinking with the previous conversations I've had with Dr. Jesse Russell, a friend of mine, viewers can find our interviews on my channel. And he's spoken a lot about this sort of war between the antinomian globalist, globo-homo left wing of the world order and the Zionist, Judeo-Christian, capitalist right wing of the world order, nationalist wing of the world order. Now, to what extent, and as you've both, I think, elucidated better than anyone, really, that is a controlled synagogue project, but it's layered. So at certain levels, people really are invested in that conflict and they really think it is true. And I just wonder that with that document, you also have on the same day, Francis really not on board with the Israeli genocide that is going on, with him saying that the IDF sniper who murdered two women outside a Catholic church in Gaza, who were availing themselves of the lavatory, was an act of terrorism. And then suddenly you have this response from these figures who are at least adjacent to the right wing of the world order. It just raises questions. And I just put that out there as a puzzle, which I don't really, can't get to the bottom of. But I think that it's worth noting that Dr. Russell presented several cases, to take two of them, when John Paul II came out against the Iraq war. That then was followed, seemingly unconnected events, but it was followed by the Boston Globe scandal. And the mass abuse and cover-ups that took place in the Boston Archdiocese were kind of generally known. It was like an open secret to anyone on the ground. But why is it that largely Jewish-controlled press detonated that scandal at the same time? I think this goes again to the post-Vatican II mechanism of control that is keeping the church suppliant and under control, where financial and sexual blackmail is a kind of currency. And any kind of deviation from the messianistic track is clamped down on with this kind of thing. So that's a question mark there. Another one was when Theodore McCarrick was involved under the Obama administration in the negotiation of the JCPOA deal, with, I think JCP, something like that, the deal with Iran, the Iran nuclear deal, which certainly angered, again, the right-wing side of Jewish power significantly, and was a large part of why, Sheldon Adelson and all these other big donors got behind Trump to punish the Democrats for that, and to reverse that Iranian nuclear deal. And for some reason, Cardinal Theodore McCarrick of Washington, who was very involved with power circles, was involved in that negotiation. I get the US doesn't have diplomatic representation in Tehran. It sort of happened through the Vatican. I don't know. But he, again, it seemed like that there was a timing, there was a kind of sequencing where the revelation of his sexual sins, which again were widely known, occurred after he'd really offended this power. And then finally, why is it that the ADL is suddenly kind of, people are allowed to criticize them now, Jonathan Greenblatt especially? Well, yes. He gave an interview with, was it Al Sharpton, I think? I might need to just double check this, but with Al Sharpton, which very much angered, again, the Likudnik kind of right wing side of the world order. I don't know if it's Al Sharpton. Another black civil rights figure who was involved with the Crown Heights riot. Yeah, Al Sharpton. It was Al Sharpton. The Crown Heights riot, which was a kind of black anti-Semitic riot, which for those people put someone like Al Sharpton beyond the pale. And yet here's Jonathan Greenblatt engaging with the kind of cultural Marxism that really irritated them. Perhaps there was some kind of pushback against the ADL for that. That's why you're kind of allowed to criticize it now, why Elon Musk is allowed to swear at them on Twitter. So that's a puzzle, as I say, because that sort of presumes that there is genuine discord and division rather than it all being top-down controlled. But there's many layers to this.
I agree, and that a lot of good points. And Will and I say this all the time, to kind of keep the spectacle legit, you have to throw out some breadcrumbs to pull people back in. Of this larger macro geostrategic alchemical brew, which is Zionism and communism, for lack of better terms, I think there is layering. A lot of people are truly within their grid. As operatives, not seeing the whole thing, but fighting one force against the other. One part, I think, with this controlled revelation and the piece that is the chaos magic, which is the grease that kind of keeps the grand dialectic going, is within that chaos magic brew is always a mix of the sacred and the profane. So when we think about bombs going down on one of the oldest Christian churches in the world, And it's really the absence of recognition from the Christian world that's really the perverted part of it. Or revelations of, Will and I were saying that, even the shocking part within the faithful, that somebody that consecrates the host within the traditional setting, you know, the most sacred of settings, you find out about just the salacious nature of his private life and some of these things coming out. And some of them I think are natural, but I mean, it is searing the consciousness in, and ultimately I think you throw a lot of things out and, you know, at the micro level, and an alchemist does what the Roman Empire does in terms of their, in terms of how they, gave gratitude to their gods. It's alchemical. What kind of works? What keeps it going? So at one point, it's got to be kind of controlled mischief, but it's that key element is it seems to always be present with these revelations. Is there seems to be a mixing of the sacred and the profane, or even the perverted. I'll throw it over to you, Will, unless you have a quick response to that, Theo.
No, please, Will, go ahead.
Yeah. I'm out of points here, so I think I'll hand it back over to you all, or if we're ready to start wrapping up, or if there's any closing ideas.
Well,
go ahead, Theo.
Just to respond to your points there, Doug, I think we're excellent in your, again, it's always returning with the eyes of faith. How does these events we see unfolding, how is it acting as a kind of propulsion towards the end times and towards the Antichrist and the sort of meta egregore that is perhaps necessary for that, and it revolves around consent, as you've articulated, I think most fully, really. So when we see this, to return us to the controlled noticing, when we see truths revealed, that shouldn't necessarily be taken as a great victory for Christ the King, for recognition of the social reign of Christ the King. Rather, we can see there that it is procuring consent from people, and it's this paradox of the pangs of revelation are kind of deepened by concealment, and the concealment itself intensifies the revelation. It's Kabbalistic, and it's, again, we Westerners who are used to Hellenistic categories of thought, where we have all sorts of, acts of the mind and logical axioms that we breathe, even in the very decrepit Western culture that we inhabit, is not the logical foundation of Judaic thought, of this of Kabbalistic thought, which is dialectical, which is Solomonic, which is spirals. It's very this is the mystery of iniquity. It is something that's very difficult, and this is, I think, one of our greatest challenges, really, in sort of sounding the alarm about engineered apocalypticism, is that it is not going to follow the sort of the logical pattern that even kind of post-Christian man, that you know, with 2,000 years of Christian history expressed, divine revelation expressed through Greek philosophical categories, is going to expect. And that's really difficult for us to put a finger on and to express to others, but we have to do our best.
Yeah, the one of the Weimar thinkers, Jakob Taubes, in his diabolical book, Occidental Eschatology, states that that the dialectic is an alternative ontology to analogy. So within analogy, like you were talking about with the nation, is a family of families, has this paternal familial structure, which points up to, through similarity, toward the kingdom of God and through God as Father. Likewise, in opposition to that, the dialectic works out through contrast, through tensions, through contradiction. And this is actually, you know, one of the mystical paradigms is that through the unity and struggle of opposites, being comes into being. And that's how we push, you know, history forward, through dialectical tensions. And I think understanding reality in those sense of, like, you know, built in with that if progress and motion forward and, the hope in a utopia or a millenarian future, if it's being worked out through this sort of owning our opposition, we're in a way consenting to the conflict in a way that it's should be pointed through similarity to what's good, true, and beautiful, if that makes any sense.
That was nice, Will. I think it's a nice way to finish things. Well, we're going to wind this down. In my mind, this was an amazing conversation. Theo, thank you so much. Wow. It's a great setup. And I thoroughly enjoyed the conversation. I can't help myself. We might throw a link down in the description. This book was actually blurbed by Theo, and we'll leave a link to his site, which is Vendée Radio. And the kind of ideas he presents on here, sometimes he presents his own ideas, and sometimes he interacts with guests that bring similar ideas. So if you've never checked out Vendée Radio, please do. There's a lot there to chew on, and you can go back from episodes from 1, 2, 3 years ago, all the way back to 5 or 6 years ago. And you don't have to grab the latest thing. There's a lot there. So we'll leave a link for that. And I want to say thank you very much, Theo. It's been an absolute pleasure having you on Dr. Deep State today.
Dr. Haugen, Will, it's been a real pleasure. Thank you so much.
Yeah, for sure. And you have a great evening over there in England. Will, I hope everything's going well with you out there in Kentucky. And I'm going to say goodbye to everybody and thank you all. And thank everybody out there in Dr. Deep State world. We do really appreciate everybody that watched the show and has been watching. And our prayers are with all of you, and I hope your prayers are with all of us. So we're going to sign out now. Bye, y'all.